reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, "Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words." So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me, "Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done?" says the Lord. "Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. At one moment I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy it. But if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will change my mind about the disaster that I intended to bring on you. And at another moment, I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will build and plant it. But if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will change my mind about the good that I had intended to do to it. Now, therefore, say to the people of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, look, I am a potter shaping evil against you and devising a plan against you. Turn now, all of you, from your evil way and amend your ways and your doings."
For the word of the Lord, thanks be to God.
Thank you. Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith toward the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful, both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but as more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way, or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me, even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. One more thing. Prepare a guest room for me, for I am hoping through your prayers to be restored to you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greetings to you, and so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. For the word of the Lord.
Thank you. beginning at verse 25.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Large crowds were travelling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost, to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot then, while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciples if you do not give up all your possessions. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure heap. They throw it away. Let anyone with ears to hear listen." For the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
And so, there will be the greening of the space all around us. There will be this move from hibernation to the activity of witnessing God's caressing care of God's creation that points to the beauty of the earth and all of life in its various forms. In fact, no one greater than John Rutter has this beautiful video or even song that talks about the beauty of the earth and how life just comes about. This creative design and reality is beautifully expressed even today in the words of the hymns that we will be singing, the hymn that we have sung. And so as we sing and we continue to sing, and as we are transformed by what we utter with our lips, let us always strive towards the safeguarding of creation. And our part as stewards of God's creation, as part of God's creative order, by giving full expression to the beauty that surrounds us each and every day. I know that many churches throughout our diocese would use the Sundays, or particular Sunday during September until the 2nd of October, to give that expression and thanks to God for the beauty of creation, which includes each and every one of us. We are also blessed, though it only happens this part and maybe some one or two other parts of the world, which is custom on the first Sunday in September, to be celebrating Father's Day, when we give thanks to God for our dads, those living and departed, and for their significant contribution, love, care, and nurture of us. And many will do this in their own significant way. But I also want to believe that we want to remember the many mothers who so often have to assume the role of both parents in single parent situations. And the fact that we are often reminded that though we refer to God as Father, that God is our parent. God is the one who loves us beyond all measure, and to whom no one can measure up to in terms of that relationship. God gives us an example of how to love, to be loved, and to live in and throughout love. And so we give thanks to God for creation. We give thanks to God for those whom God has given us, those whom we can call dad or father. We give thanks to God for their significant contribution in our lives. But as our theme for today reminds us, that it is all about the cost of discipleship, which in essence means us looking at what it involves in being a follower of Jesus Christ. Now, it is easy to understand the gospel reading in the context of Jesus' day and age in society, because that was a missionary age, an age in which people wanted to make known to others this new kind of faith adherence, maybe religiosity, and how people needed to respond. But it was also the time in which Jesus called many others to follow and to serve. And it would almost seem impossible, the task that Jesus gives to these disciples in relation to their following. Here they are called, using the words within the Gospel according to St. Luke, to in fact hate their mother, father, wife, children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, if they wanted to be a disciple of Jesus. Later, we're reminded that they need to let go of all their possessions, everything they had, in order to follow. And there were those who literally did this within the context of Jesus in his ministry excursion, even amongst the people of God. There were those who were willing to leave mother and father, husband, wife, brother or sister, in order to follow Jesus and be a disciple of our Lord. And one might think today that this was rather an unfair request. But this is how people were so serious about following Jesus, wanting to be a disciple, that they would let go of all in relation to following. But then the crux comes within this gospel reading, where we are called to carry our cross. to follow. Because once again, if we do not carry the cross, we cannot follow or cannot be a disciple. If we do not give up all our possessions, we cannot be a disciple. Such great demands on a people who fell in love with this person who has given all of himself to all of them, to all of us, in a most sacrificial way. Yes, there were those who followed. There were even other times when Jesus made particular requests. Whether this was the interpretation of those who wrote the gospel, or whether these were the authentic words of Jesus, we see that there is still a cost associated in relation to our discipleship. What are we to do today within our day and age and context? First of all, we are not in that missionary age or stage, but we know the story all too well. We know that there is a call for us to follow Jesus, to follow his way, to walk with God, and for us to walk with each other in relation to our discipleship. Maybe there is a cost involved, but it is not one of leaving mother, brother, father, or sister, or even hating them more, because I believe that Jesus is not asking people to hate others more, but maybe he's asking us to love even more, to love him above all else, above everyone else, in order to prove to ourselves that we are worthy of being those disciples of our Lord. We are not even called to give up our possessions. We are just simply called to follow, and through our following make the difference. Yet we are still called to carry our cross, which might mean various and different things to all of us at different times within our lives. When Jesus calls us to carry our cross, he calls us to the life of discipleship. Not only the pain that the cross would seem to be, but also the joy of salvation, the joy of freedom, the joy of life, the joy of being able to continue within our lives the best way which we can. For our following today is not about giving up or hating or maybe even loving more, but just simply called to follow and to love. Yes, to follow God, to follow Jesus, and to love beyond all measure. And through this love, be able to transform this world for ministry and service. The call to follow means to accept all those God has given us to love, and to embrace each and every person as the most special person. If that is the cost, I am very happy to bear it. But what a wonderful opportunity from this God of love who calls us to follow, to be able to exercise the true characteristic of discipleship, and that is to give ourselves unconditionally to the other, and to be seen as God's people within God's church and in God's world, transforming and setting this place on fire with the love of God. Yes, there is this understanding that there is an absolute plan to derive, or to design, in order to get a certain result, as we are reminded within the Gospel reading, which in essence reminds us that if we fail to plan, we will plan to fail. But even in this, we are still to strategically engage within our ministry activities. And even as we engage within those ministry activities, we need to be able to uphold that wonderful cost, that cost in which Jesus gave all of himself to all of us on the cross. And through this cost of being a disciple, to simply offer that love to the least of our neighbors. This is the way in which we can be God's people within God's church and God's world. This is the way in which we can transform the church, society, for ministry and service. For many times a transformation does not need to happen outside within the context of the world, but it needs to happen here. We need to be the ones to fill others with this love of God, so that they too may follow and feel the privilege it is to be part of this ministry excursion, to be part of this gospel enterprise, to be part of this God who has given all of God's self to all of us in the life, the ministry, and the mission of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so, yes, if we calculate costs in relation to our disciples, let us know one thing for sure, that the real cost, or the only cost, is to be able to exercise that which God has given us so freely, that which is inherent within each one of us. That is the love of God. To share that love of God with all that we meet, irrespective of person. That as we see God's kingdom and God's righteousness, that we will place God's love over and above all. So as we give thanks to God for creation, as we give thanks to God for fathers, for parents, let us give thanks to God for the opportunity of being able to love and to bring this very easy us into the equation and so transform the world for Christian ministry and service. For ministry and service, but let the transformation start where we are, so that others too may come into the full promises of those who are called to be followers and disciples. The Lord be with you.
Let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father, through him.
Give you thanks that you have created a world of great beauty and wonder. We pray for those places throughout the world where your creation has been marred by human greed and selfishness, where your creatures are threatened with extinction, and where places of beauty have been polluted or destroyed. We pray for the millions of people affected by the floods in Pakistan. And we pray too for those countries torn apart by war and conflict, praying for the people of Ukraine, Sri Lanka, Afghanistan, Syria, Israel, and Palestine. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, our Redeemer, give you thanks that you sent your Son to show us the way to love you and our neighbours. We pray for your church, for all agencies which promote care for creation, and for all who work in development agencies, especially those in places with environmental problems. Within the Anglican Church of Australia, we pray today for the Diocese of Ballarat, for Bishop Gary Weatherall, and the clergy and people of that diocese. Within our own diocese, we pray for Bishop Clarence, Michelle, Kian and Kyle, and today for the parochial district of Alpine, for the Reverend Moira Evans, and the clergy and congregations of St. All Saints, Bright, St. Etheldreda's, Harrietville, St. Paul's, Myrtleford, and St. John's, Warrell. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, our unity, we give you thanks that you draw people to share a common life and to work together for the building up of genuine community. We pray for our local community, praying especially for all local environmental efforts, for those who care for our waterways, and those who seek to make Wangaratta a cleaner, better place to live. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, our sustainer, we give you thanks that you bring healing to the vulnerable and sick. We pray for all who are in need or distress, for the hungry, homeless or unemployed, for those in pain or grief. We pray for all on our parish list of prayer, and all those whose pain is known only to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, our Saviour, we give you thanks that by your loving hands we were created, and you shape our days. We give you thanks for all who have followed you faithfully to their life's end, and who are now in your keeping. For the recently departed and those whose year's mind falls this week. Give us the courage to follow you in the company of all your saints, that we too may come into the joy of your everlasting presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers.
Grant for what we ask in faith, we may by your grace receive. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We are the body of Christ.
His Spirit is with us.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Share. Thank you. can obtain an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, we lift our voices to praise you.
Thank you.
Bountiful God, this day will you graciously feed us with the bread of life and the cup of eternal salvation. May we, who have reached out our hands to receive the sacrament, be strengthened in your service. We, who have sung your praises, tell of your glory and truth in our lives. And we, who have seen the greatness of your love, see you face to face in your kingdom. Come to worship you with all your saints forever. Father,
we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Send us out of the power of the Spirit to live in the words of your praise and glory.
God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you.